If you don't care about your privacy, that's your privilege. But as a society, we can't afford to give up on privacy, just like we can't afford to give up on free speech. My name is Arvind Narayanan. I'm a professor of computer science at Princeton University. One of the areas that I study is AI. I've also done a lot of research on privacy. What connects these topics is I'm motivated by tech accountability. Back in 2006, Netflix released the movie viewing records of 500,000 of their customers, and this was for the purpose of a machine learning competition. What they had said was that because the customers had been de-identified because their names were not attached to those movie viewing records, there was nothing to be concerned about from a privacy perspective. At the time, I was doing my PhD, and so my advisor, Vitaly Shmatikov, and I, we smelled a rat. I wondered, could we cross-correlate people's reviews on IMDb with the set of movies that they had watched on Netflix? And we were able to show that that was possible in some cases. So that's when I first started recognizing that the assurances that companies might give people on privacy might not, in fact, stand up to scrutiny. One of the other areas where I was hearing this a lot is, yeah, we're tracking everything you're doing on your apps, but it's all anonymous. So we started to look into that, and we just, you know, we fell into this whole minefield of, you know, the really, really invasive, sneaky tracking that's happening on our devices. And no, it's not really all anonymous, because it might be attached to something like your so-called hashed email address, and it can be used to connect all of your profiles from one device to another, and so it can still be used to build this one kind of Uber profile of you, and there are dozens of companies who specialize in doing that. One thing we didn't expect when we started doing all this privacy research is that it would be Silicon Valley versus Silicon Valley. Today, probably the biggest protector of privacy is Apple, perhaps even more effective than a lot of the privacy regulations around the world, which are certainly also important. A lot of AI technologies today do have powerful capabilities, but they also have important limits, and so we should be very careful about relying on them. There are many kinds of technologies that are clubbed under this umbrella term, AI. Often, these technologically have very little to do with each other, except that they're all forms of machine learning, they learn from data, and just because technology is quickly moving in one type of AI, most notably generative AI recently, doesn't mean that all of these other applications of AI are getting better or more accurate. It doesn't mean necessarily that they should be used at all. I've had the suspicion for many, many years now that a lot of the AI technologies that are being sold to predict people's future behavior don't actually work. These kinds of algorithms are used by banks for lending. They're used by insurance companies. This is happening in hiring when people apply for jobs. This is happening even in the criminal justice system when it comes to decisions about bail and parole. But when you look at the accuracy of these models, it's barely better than random. So is it ethical to make these consequential decisions about people when they're only slightly more accurate than the flip of a coin? That's one issue with these things. There are well-known racial biases and other kinds of biases in these models. As a kid, I thought of technology as automatically a force for good. But what I started to realize growing up, that what tech does is it amplifies both the best and the worst of society. Machine learning algorithms are fundamentally about finding patterns in a data set and then reflecting those patterns in their outputs. So ultimately, any of these data sets is generated by people, and people live in a society, and so there are both individual biases and the structural biases of society itself that are almost always captured. When it comes to AI and fairness, who gets to decide is really the elephant in the room. And I think that's perhaps the most important question. Does the decision maker or the developer of the algorithm have a process to get community input from various stakeholders, from the people who are going to be subject to these decisions, and try to figure out what all the different trade-offs are? I think even when a technology gets very rapidly deployed and it's beneficial to those in positions of power, when everyday people feel that it's unjust, they can and have been able to successfully push back. And that should be front of mind for us when we see dubious applications of technology. We shouldn't take it for granted.